I work a lot with the Kentucky Student Environmental Coalition, and we fight for a lot of those things, so like coal and stuff.
Yes.
I don't know your personal opinion right now, but we weren't very supportive of
you were or were not?
We're not.
Of coal?
Of his perspective.
Of his perspective?
And the way he talked about Appalachian lifestyle.
Yeah.
And we thought that it didn't really portray it.
You know, I don't know. He lived it.
Yeah.
Think about it.
Well, we just felt he had a very capitalistic and made it seem almost
unidimensional.
Yeah. That just kind of made he somebody maybe could have done it a little better.
Right. Right. So, you know, I urge all of you guys to read this book. It is really a great, great read. And basically, this guy was born in eastern Kentucky, in Appalachia, in just very horrific conditions. Just, you can't even, you gotta write a book. It's that bad. You know, his conditions are so bad. His mom was married 6 times, his mom's a drug addict, he was raised by his grandmother, and you know, his family moved from eastern Kentucky to Ohio, Middletown, Ohio, and the conditions there are pretty horrific as well. And so it's his life story about how, where he came from and where he ended up. So where he ended up, finally, he went to Yale Law School, which, you know, from the context of the world that he comes from, I mean, they probably don't even know what Yale is, or where it is, or what this place is. So it just kind of talks about his journey. It is very eye-opening because everybody thinks that they have it, you know, really, really bad, until you start reading about how bad things are just in general in so many different places, and you end up with a great appreciation for different things. So I like to read books like that. I like to read, you know, biographies. I like to read inspirational books. I don't have a lot of time to read, but, you know, I'm surrounded by business books in my house all over the place. But I personally enjoy reading a lot of biographies and also historical biographies. The other half-read book that's sitting there and I keep trying to read it is called The Agony and the Ecstasy. Anybody knows about it. Maybe it is Emily probably knows about it. It's the life of Michelangelo and his entire journey from when he was 5 years old to his whole journey through his life and how he painted the Sistine Chapel and all that. So they're like two ends of the spectrum, like 500 years apart, but you know, they're on like an eclectic mix of stuff. Questions? Anything? Feedback?
I'll pass. I mean, I have like 17.
You can ask. All 17. I don't care.
What are your goals for Glow Touch?
My goals for Glow Touch are basically, we've set a goal of doubling in size of the company over the next 3 to 5 years. So that's the capitalistic goal for Glow Touch. And the reason we have that goal is because it really is a way for us to continue to invest in educational technology products that we have. We want to kind of,
you know, you can like brush off people.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yeah, it's good. I'm pretty keen back. That's always a good sign. So are you guys enjoying your time here so far?
Yes.
Different?
Yes.
Interesting? That's cool. So, here? Okay, all right. Can I not move at all? Am I not going to be able to move around?
I can make it so that you're no longer stuck in a corner. Like,
okay.
You can. Jesus Christ. All right, yeah, now you can move in front of the TV
just
if you want.
Just a little bit? Okay, all right, cool.
Can you tell me about
the seat? There's two seats.
What? Just grab another chair.
Oh, well, there's two seats.
Okay. So, Sam, you want to just drive one from out there? So, all right, cool. Okay. All right, so as you guys know, we're gonna try to do a presenter series over the next few weeks, and we've got some really great people lined up, and we're we're so excited. Hopefully they've shared information about the people that we know of so far. You all haven't done that, okay? They will share information with you. And I am honored to be the first person to be part of this presenter series, talking to you guys. I am just really excited. And I cannot tell you, we have been looking forward to having you guys here for the last 2 months, ever since we started talking about the program. We've been really excited to see, you know, who's gonna come in and what you all are gonna be able to learn from this and take away, and just what an experience you're gonna have, so you can tell us how it's going so we can continue to keep making improvements. But as you guys know, I am the president of Blow Touch Technologies. We are a software company, so we do custom software development, we do programming, we do mobile development, all the apps you see on your phone, and so we do a lot of technology services for a lot of companies around the world. Our clients are worldwide, so we actually have a number of clients in North America, some in Europe, a whole bunch of clients in Asia. And I've been doing this is my 15th year of doing this. I started the company 15 years ago. So what I wanted to do today for you is kind of start at the beginning and tell you how I ended up doing what I'm doing now, and give you a little bit of, I've been calling it the story of me. I've been telling everybody, today I'm doing the story of me. But what I want you guys to do is stop me at any time and ask me questions, because there may be things that I've missed, there may be things that I'm not covering, maybe things that you're interested in learning specifically more about. And so I want you guys to ask me questions. Has everybody been asking questions, at least one question a day, every day, since we started? Okay, yes? Somebody not done that? If somebody's not done that, this is your opportunity to ask 3 questions today, because it's day 3. So that would be a good way to kind of even it out for the week, right? My educational background is not in software, and it's not in technology. My background is in molecular biology. So what does that have to do with software, right? I mean, I'm a molecular biologist. I went to graduate school to study that, and then I sort of moved into technology over the last many years. And my dad is a professor, just to give you some context. His dad was a professor. And I think his dad before that was an educator. So I always thought my calling was in education. I always thought I was gonna end up as a teacher or a professor or, you know, something in that area. And nothing else mattered in my house, as you can well imagine, other than education. Absolutely nothing was important. It was priority number one, priority number two, priority number three. That was it. And all my parents wanted me and my brother to do really was kind of, you know, focus on your studies. You know, that's what my dad did every day of his life. That's what my grandfather did every day of his life. So my parents, you know, obviously are from India, and I was born there, my brother was born there. And you'll hear me talk a lot about my brother as well, and you'll see why, you know, he's so integral to the story of, you know, where we are today. So that was the one thing that was drilled into our heads. So as, you know, a family of basically in the education area as professors, you know, it was a pretty ordinary home. It wasn't anything spectacular, it wasn't anything extraordinary. We weren't like, you know, a very wealthy family. We were just an average middle class, you know, normal family, but education always came first. And my dad was a Fulbright scholar. Some of you may know what that is. So he did his PhD and he was a Fulbright scholar. So he came to the United States back in the 80s to teach. And then he went back to India because his father was not just a professor, he also had a publishing company. So he actually, you know, wrote books, textbooks for high school and college. And so all of his colleagues from his professor life were his business partners that were actually writing textbooks. So they were in the textbook business. So literally, like, my entire memory of my whole childhood is being around textbooks being in a printing press where textbooks are being printed, you know, authors are kind of, you know, meeting with my family. So you can imagine that's pretty much the only world that I knew growing up. I didn't even know about this whole other world of, you know, non-academic where people are doing sports or people are doing other activities. I was just surrounded by people, education, educators. And that's sort of the value system that was inculcated in me. And when I was getting ready, well, my dad came to the US, came back to India to help his dad run the business. So that's why they ended up back in India. But the entire time, they were always very clear that my brother and I would come to the US to get our education, either our education at the undergraduate level or beyond that. So that wasn't even something that was optional. That's sort of what they wanted us to do, because this was the place where you could get the best education. So where else are you gonna go, right? So, and that was always the plan, and that's what our family was working towards. But what happened along the way is, you know, I applied to a lot of colleges when I was in high school, like you guys in the US, and I got accepted by a lot of colleges, very elite institutions, you know, some Ivy League schools. But then there was something called reality, which, you know, we didn't really kind of think about, because you're always talking about, oh, how exciting is this? This is so great. You know, I take all my SATs and I get like close to perfect scores. I have perfect score in math. You know, I'm like, okay, great. So now I'm going to be able to go to all these great universities, right? So, and then, you know, you start looking at, oh my God, you know, what is this thing? Like, how much is this thing gonna cost, right? So, and all of a sudden, like, oh, and then you're a professor in India, you're making money in this other currency called rupees, which has a different value. When you convert it into this other currency called US dollars, which is very expensive, and then, like, oh, I don't think this is gonna work out, you know? So that was just the first shock, because you're working towards a goal, you kind of get there, and now you got to actually take the next step. You have to go and, you know, you have to actually pay for school. And then you all, fortunately, none of you have this problem. If you are not a US citizen or a green card holder, if you're not born here, the universities don't really provide any kind of assistantships or fellowships or financial aid, because that's reserved for people that are here, which makes total sense, you know. So what ended up happening is that I couldn't come here to study because my family couldn't afford it. There was just no way, you know. It was just so much of a stretch. And so I ended up doing my undergraduate education in India, and the really thing about it is my parents didn't really have to pay for anything. I ended up getting a scholarship to study there. In India, it's very difficult to get scholarships, so we were really surprised that the government actually paid me to study. I mean, I was an extremely good student. All I did was study, right? So obviously you're gonna end up being really good. I didn't really go out and do like cool things. The only extracurricular things I did was speech and debate or essay, right? Everything still, you know, very much in the academic world. I never did anything other, I didn't know. So I'm studying there, but my brother comes along. You know, he's 4 years younger than I am. And my parents decide, we're never gonna let this happen to our other child. Now we know how much everything costs, and so we're gonna go into this with our eyes open. So what he ends up doing is he comes to the US very, very young. He was still in high school. He had only finished his sophomore year. And he came here on a youth exchange program through the Rotary. You all probably know about Rotary International. They're a big worldwide organization. They're sort of a service organization. And so he comes to the US, and he's only 14, he's very young, you know. So, but then for a year, he kind of lives in three different families. And in the year that he was here, he doubles up on everything in high school. He finishes his high school kind of like somewhere between 14 and 15. You know, and now we're like, okay, he's applying to colleges. He gets accepted to a whole bunch of colleges. Also, he's also a very, very good student. Gets in everywhere. And again, even though they already knew, by then, you know, the costs have really gone up some more, and everything costs even more, and then we find ourselves in the exact same situation at that point. So he comes back to India, and he starts college, at an engineering college in India. And 2 months into it, you know, he got an opportunity, got accepted to another school that said, we'll give you, like, you know, a little bit of money. I don't remember what it was, like $5,000 or something like that. And so my parents are like, okay, great. Okay, now you're going to go. You're going to go do your undergraduate education in the U.S. So he comes here, then it's 4 years, right? So you can't, like, just pay for one semester and then not finish your other 7 semesters. And they don't kind of tell us the whole story. The story is that money is only there. It's like a hook to get you in, and then you're kind of stuck. So this is what my family does. And the reason I'm telling you guys this is because I want you to understand what you see today is not what it was. You know, it's been a very long road to get here. So what did my parents do? My parents sold their house. They sold their cars. They sold everything they owned, absolutely everything. They moved in to a really small rental apartment. Why? Because they're trying to put my brother through college. And he's here, they're over there, he's on his own, you know, he doesn't have a support system, he doesn't have anybody, so we're all kind of trying to help, you know. I mean, I was glad that I was, you know, already getting paid to study over there, so I wasn't a burden on them. And so, you know, so all of this happens. He transfers from the school he was at because that was kind of a bait and switch school. We didn't know anything. We just didn't know. It was like, it was a place where they kind of get you in and then they try to, like, make you pay the tuition, the rest of it. It wasn't a very good school. So he transfers after a year. He went to Mississippi State University, you know, and then he goes there. Now, every semester from every few months, you know, a semester rolls around pretty quickly. It was just terrible because my parents had to ask people, everybody they knew, to help financially. They went to the banks, they got all kinds of loans, even after, like, selling everything. Still, you know, the cost of college, even back then, was really, really, really out of reach for an average person. So every few months, trying to get more money, asking people, getting loans, going to the banks, it's just an absolute nightmare. And what we didn't know is nightmare for my brother was a whole lot worse than the difficulty for us, because he's here completely on his own, very young. And even with everything they're trying to do, there were many, many times he never told us at that time that he would periodically get kicked out of where he was staying because he didn't pay the bills, he couldn't, you know, afford to, like, just be in the apartment, electricity would get cut off, you know, water would get turned off. None of us knew anything. He's not telling us how bad it was for him, and we're not telling him how bad it is for us. So that, guys, is the value of what an education should be for everybody. It was just the worst 4 years, you know, more or less. Like I said, I didn't know what I was going to talk about, but it was tough. It was a tough, you know, tough ride. But he finishes up, you know, he finishes 4 years of college, gets a great job. He went, you know, he studied electrical engineering. It was all technology for him. And he didn't tell us that he actually stayed in his lab, like, many nights. He had a mentor that he was doing research under. That mentor knew how difficult it was for him financially, that he would just let him sleep in the lab sometimes. It was an NSF-funded facility in Starkville, Mississippi, and some days he would just sort of turn a blind eye and say, this kid is so dedicated, he's here, he's studying, he's doing his work. So sometimes he would stay there, sometimes he's told us later that he has actually sat outside his apartment under, you know, an electric light, just, like, sitting there not knowing where to go or what to do, you know. So. But through it all, he never quit. We never quit trying to help support him. And he finished. And from there, he went to Silicon Valley, California. Went to a company called Sun Microsystems. You guys may have heard of it. They make the software called Java, you know, which some of you may know something about. If not, you guys should learn about it. And he goes there, you know, great job, right out of school. And the really cool thing is, you know, Sun Microsystems is in Silicon Valley, which is where Stanford is. So Sun actually offered to pay for him to go to Stanford, get a really great job as an engineer working there. So he starts taking classes at Stanford. And then from there, he gets a job, goes to Massachusetts. And then, you know, I'll tell you the rest of that later. But in the meantime, you know, I finish my undergraduate education. I come here for graduate school. And, you know, when I came for graduate school, it was terrible. It was terrible. I mean, I had no funding, no assistantship. You know, I remember what Ms. McLean told us about her graduate assistantship and how she was able to get it. I had nothing. So I came, and my first week, I started working at the Taco Bell on campus. That was my first job. It was great because they fed me, right? So. So it was great because when I would go and work, that was like my meal for like the whole day. And they were really nice. They would allow us to take, like they would let us eat there and take something with us. So I didn't have to worry about it. But, so I finished my master's degree, and through this whole time, we're still trying to like help all of us, trying to, you know, help my brother. And on $4.25 an hour at Taco Bell, that was how much they paid. That's all they paid. You know, you're trying to take care of your needs, you're trying to take care of your family's needs, you're trying to take care of all kinds of stuff. So they were some interesting and tough days, you know, back then. But, you know, I finished my master's degree, then I go to work for a really cool company called Pioneer Hybrid. And since my background is molecular biology, it's a company that was in that area. They do engineered.
Where did you go to graduate school?
Oh, I went to graduate school. Actually, I started at Clemson University. I went there for a semester, and then I transferred to Virginia Tech because the professor there had an assistantship for me. Thank you for reminding me or asking the question. And so I go there. They're paying me now, finally. Someone's paying me to go to college. I was like, you know, about time. And they were also paying me like $600 a month. I just couldn't believe, like, this was the most money I had ever seen in my whole entire life, $600 a month, you know, so. And it was great because a year I was there. But then what happens is funding runs out after a year. So you still got to finish another year left in school, right? So there's no funding available. And he's like, well, I can't really do anything. And so that was the time when I actually met Vic, who you met yesterday. He was a graduate student, also electrical engineering, at Virginia Tech, and I had just met him. And that was a time I was gonna run out of money in my department with my professor, and so I was telling him about this. And then I see a job posting in my department's like bulletin board that says webmaster required. It pays $11 an hour, like to be a webmaster. I'm like, what the hell is a webmaster? That sounds like it's a lot of money. Like, maybe I should go be a webmaster, right? So I told him, I said, do you know anything about this webmaster thing? Like, he said, yeah, it's just HTML, you know? I mean, it's good, it's not that difficult to learn. I said, well, can you teach me? So I just met him, right? So, and he said, yeah, sure, there's some online websites I can maybe show you. So you know how it is when you meet somebody really interesting, you know, you go out and do fun things, you go out and like have a good time. Instead, here we are like in front of the computer, he's teaching me how to build HTML websites, right? This is kind of how we met. And he's the ultimate geek, I'm the ultimate geek, and so we were very happy, you know, honestly. Just, it was just like match made in heaven. It was great. And so literally over a weekend, I learned HTML. I just sat there in front of the computer, and the really good thing back in those days is they had very few tags. Like, they only had, you know, this was HTML like 1.0, you know, long time ago. There wasn't even very much to it. So I learned it, and on Monday, and I went to my department and I said, I want to be the webmaster for the department. They said, do you know anything? I said, yeah, absolutely. I know how to do HTML. They said, okay, because nobody else had raised their hand, you know, in our department, because it was the life science, the College of, you know, Life Sciences, where most people didn't know anything about technology. So, you know, so I went there, didn't know what I didn't know, you know, basically I didn't know anything. But that was okay, because somebody actually said, I know it. They said, okay, sure, you can have it. And then my professor was really, you know, nice to try and get me a tuition waiver. So here I was, you know, from the life sciences area, now making a leap into technology, which I don't know anything about, and I'm learning it as I go. But the only thing I knew is, how hard can this darn thing be? Cannot be that hard. I mean, I'm doing like very complicated, you know, I'm doing genetic mapping, I'm doing sequencing, I'm doing all of this other stuff. Compared to that, this stuff seems super easy. Like, okay, it's logical, right? I mean, it just, you do different things and then it does different things on the screen. Can't be that bad. So the only thing I had at that time was just complete blind faith. I had nothing else. A little bit of knowledge, a lot of blind faith. So you guys need to be thinking about that. Just because you don't know a lot about something doesn't mean that you're not going to be able to get there. Always say yes, right? Always take the risk. Always use any opportunity to say that, yes, I can get there. How hard can this stuff be? It's, I mean, somebody else is doing it. Somebody else doing it over here. I can figure it out, right? So, and that's what I did. And so from there, I went to work for, you know, a company. I graduated, went to work for another company, and a company in Des Moines, in my area. But I had a really cool job. I had a really interesting job. Today, that job has a name. It's called bioinformatics. Back then, it didn't have a name because it was early 90s. Like that field as a study, as a discipline, didn't exist. So it was basically using technology in life sciences, where you have a lot of people that do a whole bunch of research in the lab. They speak one language. A whole bunch of people in the technology world, they speak a totally different language. And the two don't know how to talk to each other. They just don't know how to communicate with each other. And my job was to be the person that would go to the labs and say, okay, what are you working on? You know, okay, I understand all of the techniques that they're using in the lab, but I also understand the technology. So I helped basically write a lot of you know, projects and requirements for people in the IT department to take work from the researchers to be able to help them build the software so the researchers could use it. So that was great. I did that for 3 years, and then I came here, and I was working for a company called National Processing here. By now, I have made the switch completely into technology. I've kind of left that world behind. I moved into technology, and primarily the reason I did that is because an academic environment is a tough environment. It's, you know, it's very difficult because there's no certainty from year to year, semester to semester, that you're going to have grant funding, you're going to be able to keep your lab open, you have to publish so many, you know, papers, and getting tenure is very difficult, and I just didn't see myself doing all of that stuff. And so I ended up switching into technology, which I think personally for me was the best thing that ever happened to me, to go all in into technology. And so,
can you talk about how old you are at this time?
At this time, I am 1994. I'm 23.
Okay.
Yeah, 22, 23. I'm still very, I started school very early and I skipped a grade in the middle and all of that. So I finished, you know, I finished college at 21, finished graduate school around 23. So yeah, I was still pretty young. Didn't know what I didn't know, which was okay. Which was kind of, you know, completely blind. But then I moved to Louisville because the whole time, you know, Vic was here, he was at GE, we were commuting back and forth. So I ended up coming here. And I worked for a company here doing all kinds of things that I had absolutely no background in. I actually came here, my job title was webmaster, but then from there, I moved into mergers and acquisitions, I moved into e-commerce development. All of these things I had never ever had on my resume. I had no experience, I had no skills. Again, just the belief that you can't be that hard to figure out. So if you can convince somebody that you have the ability to figure it out, 99% of the time, people will take a chance on you. And the reason people don't get opportunities is because they don't tell people that I think I can figure this stuff out. Think about your peers, you know, think about the people that you're around. How many people say, I think I can figure it out? They're all gonna say, I don't know this. I'm not gonna do this because I think it's difficult. I haven't studied this. I didn't have a class in it. Guys, for you, this is an amazing time to be just about in any area, because there is nothing that you cannot get access to resources today. And I wish I were your age today, and I wish I knew all the stuff I know now, you know, your age, which is kind of difficult, right? Because you can literally choose any area of study or work or career and know nothing about it and actually figure it out so much quicker than you could back then. Because then it was all a big to-do. You had to go get your degree in this area, and you got to go do this, and you have to have so much experience. Now, just being able to get in the middle of something and try it, fail at it, do it again, go back, that's just pretty amazing. And the opportunities are all there for you guys. So, you know, let me kind of fast forward a little bit to where we are today. I started this company primarily because I was going to have a child. I mean, that's like really, you know, the existence of this company is tied, you know, to that one back there. I was traveling so much in my corporate job. I was gone all the time. I was working all the time. And I just didn't see how you could balance being home with a kid and being this corporate job. Just being able to do it all. There's just physically just no way to do it. You don't have enough hours in the day to do it. And that's the time when I said, okay, you know, something's got to change. It can't be the same way. I said, I'm going to go try doing something on my own. So, you know, so what's been happening with my brother this whole time is, you know, he went to Stanford, then he moved to Boston, he's working, and he starts a company, starts a technology company. He ends up getting a bunch of venture financing. Venture financing is when other people take, you know, enough faith and confidence in you and are willing to write you some big checks for you to go and try building your company. So by then, he's now raised like $1 million, and he raised another $12 million. So he's got all this money, he's trying to build out this company. And there's this thing called the dot-com bubble, right? So you guys should go back, kind of, 15 years and see what happened. At that time, everybody thought they had the best idea under the sun. They all thought they were all gonna become billionaires, and they all started, you know, creating these dot-com companies, and he was one of them also that thought the same thing. But then the reality hit, and then obviously you don't have a product, a service helping somebody. You can't just create a company out of air and say, look, my company's worth $1 billion. It doesn't work like that. And so there was this big, you know, market crash that happened. A lot of companies, like 95% of the dot-com companies, went belly up. A lot of people lost a lot of money, and this just happened 15 years ago. And his company was, at that time, 130 employees. And so he got a phone call from his investor. It was a Friday morning, got a phone call. And they said, by Monday morning, make sure there's only 25 people left in the building. You have to fire 100 people. Now, he's very young. He's, at that time, probably like 21, something like that, you know. What? You know, what do we do? How does that work? And where do I ask these people to go? They all came on board because they believed in me, and now I have to go fire 100 people in a weekend? So that's when he called me, and he said, like, what do we do? Like, I have to fire 100 people, you know. And it was over a span of just a couple days that we decided that I would help his company. And, you know, in the meantime, I'm trying to figure out how to get out of this corporate world. And I said, okay, I'll help you. Maybe, you know, get a small team together. I'll manage them for you, and I can have a team set up, and working in India because my dad, you know, is living there and he can help us. And you figure out what you want these people to do. So over like a few days, we went from, he went from 130 to like 25, 30 people. We said we would create this thing. And at that time, you know, for me personally, the goal was very simple. I was not looking to make a lot of money. I was not looking to just come up with a nice billion-dollar idea. I had a very small goal. I said, okay, my mortgage payment was whatever, I don't remember, like $1,500 or something. I said, if I can create something that will allow me to just pay the mortgage, then I will give up my day job and I will work on this and kind of, you know, take the risk. It was very, 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 very frightening, guys. I cannot begin to tell you what that's like, especially having lived through the experiences of not having any resources, not having any money, and then actually having a job that pays really well, and you get kind of used to a different kind of lifestyle when you know you can go to Target and not worry about whether you spend $25 or $50, right? I mean, you sort of start thinking about things differently. You don't worry so much about like the most basic of basic things. That was seriously risky, but you know, again, I said, well, how hard can this be? Let's try to see. You know, let's go and try to take a rest. And so that's kind of how we started. We started with three employees. First three employees, you know, in our operation in India, and that was me. I was everything. I was the CEO. I was the janitor. I was the project manager. I was the biz dev person. I was the finance person. I was the account. Like, there was nobody. There's no money to pay anybody, right? So I had to kind of take care of this client. And then I gotta like just try to figure out how to survive. So we quickly kind of figured out, you know, when you are put in that situation, it's amazing how resourceful people get. Like if you kind of take away the safety net and you just go into a scary situation that you don't actually know what you're gonna do, how you're gonna come out of it, you guys will really surprise yourselves about how you can really quickly think on your feet, really quickly try to figure out to not be in that situation, because nobody wants to be in that situation, right? So what I want to tell you is do not be afraid to take risks, ever, ever, because you guys have an amazing safety net. I mean, you know, you guys all have, your safety net is your knowledge. Your safety net is your education. Because, okay, whatever, this doesn't work, you have enough capabilities and skills to go do something else. Do not ever be afraid of opportunities that come to you, because you're not gonna know where that opportunity is gonna take you at that point in time. Nobody knows, you know, we can't predict the future. But if you say no at that point to an opportunity that looks like it could take you somewhere, you're really depriving yourselves of being able to kind of take it all the way and see, you know, where that can lead you. So, you know, my brother's company, in the meantime, they've kind of figured out a model. Again, same thing with him, right? They go from being a big company to now this little company, and their entire survival, their entire, like, existence is at risk. So they had to innovate and quickly figure out how to go from the model they were to being a different kind of paid model where they could sustain themselves. And they figured it out. And, you know, I kind of figured out how to bring on other clients, because I can't rely on his company to be my client. I gotta figure out how to make my own company out of it. So I'm trying to innovate, he's trying to innovate. Everybody's kind of trying to do all of this.
Okay, so where did you get your clients? Or like, were you, I'm missing like some connection, like when you started your own company?
When I started my own company, I had one client.
And where did
that was my brother.
Oh, okay.
That was the only client I had. Like, I had no clients.
Okay.
So then after that, then you start trying to figure out who do you know in big companies? Who are your friends? Who's in your network? Who do you know that knows somebody? And then you just start thinking about this whole thing very differently. Until then, you know, they're just people you hang out with on a Friday night. Now, they're not just that. They're also people that can open doors, give you introductions, and say, hey, I want you to talk to so-and-so, and they're doing this, and maybe they can help you. So everything was just referral. It was just who you know, who you can get in front of, how can you tell your story, how can you tell them what value you're adding to them. So it all becomes very different. You start thinking about things very differently at that point because it's a matter of survival.
So where did you get the idea for your company?
The idea for my company was born out of need. It wasn't even, necessity is the, or what is it?
Necessity
is the mother of invention, right? So no, we didn't invite or come up with anything clever. It was just his survival, and then me trying to do something different with my life. This is the timing, just came together. And now why do they say that fortune favors the brave? Somebody tell me, have you heard this saying? Think about it, fortune favors the brave.
If you're brave enough to go and take risks and risk it all to get what you want, then you'll end up getting it.
Exactly. So fortune basically is success, right? Success doesn't go looking for the brave person. You have to be that person to whom success has to come to because you are courageous enough to look for the opportunity. You're always open. Always stay open to opportunities because opportunities are everywhere, right? You gotta be able to stay open and don't like keep shutting the door on opportunities. So, I mean, this story, this does have a pretty good path forward. So, my brother's company, over the years, he took his company public. So he started with nothing, he took his company public, and we were all fortunate enough to be at the NASDAQ on the day he took his company public. We got to ring the bell and
what's
do
that?
All that kind of,
What's that?
Push a button.
What's the NASDAQ?
Oh, the NASDAQ is where, it's the stock exchange in New York, where if you're taking a company public, then you've got to do a whole bunch of stuff. And then basically you get listed as a public company that people can buy shares in a company.
What was the name of your brother's company?
It's called Endurance International. The other thing that I missed, even though he was running a really successful company and his company was doing real well, he'd already done his education at Stanford, all of that, he didn't stop his learning. He went to UPenn's Wharton School of Business. You guys may have heard of it. It's where our president and his entire family went to school. It really is the number one school in the world for finance. So, he's running his company, goes to Wharton, gets his MBA from Wharton, and then he's continuing to grow and run his company. And that MBA, that decision for him to go to Wharton and do this, is kind of what was able to help him propel his company from a successful company to an extremely successful company. Because obviously they teach you a lot of things about how to work with companies and how to work with finance and do all those kinds of things. So so that, I think, it doesn't matter what age you are or what stage you are, whether you go and get an education from an actual university or whether you get it on your own because you kind of put yourself out there to learning, that should never stop, no matter who you are. My mom, today's her birthday, she's 66. Every time I look at her, she's studying, what are you studying? She's decided that now she's going to take this series of exams in Sanskrit because she never studied it when she was younger. She knows, a lot using it. It's a very, very difficult language. So she's decided to sign up with a series of 10 exams, each one progressively more difficult than the other. And every time I look at her, she's got her notebook, she's right. You don't need to do it. She said, yeah, I don't need to do it. I just want to do it, right? So that's the growth mindset. You've got to keep growing. You can't ever stop, because there's just too much out there and too many opportunities to keep learning. But if you stop having the interest and the excitement to learn, then you pretty much, life is kind of over, what else do you have? She can choose to not be doing that, but she doesn't think that where does she go from there? What do you do? Every day, wake up, do the same thing, cook, clean, do whatever it is, and then the next day, now you've got a goal. A new goal, and a new goal, and a new goal, but you got to keep working your way towards. But, so a couple of things that I have learned along the way. None of these things that anything that I've told you here came easy. They were very, 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 very difficult for me to do school, to be able to get a job, to be able to, you know, start the company. It's very difficult to be taken seriously. It's very difficult for people to take women in technology seriously. It's changing now. You guys are very fortunate. We live in a very different time than when I did. And it's very difficult for your customers to take you seriously when you walk in. You know, I want to tell you a little experience that I had. In this company, you know, we had a client meeting, a potential client meeting in Atlanta. I had never met this potential client. I had my VP of sales who had been trying to, you know, work with them and set up this meeting and try to go in there and close this account, you know, bring their business on. And he was the only one that had been in touch with them this whole time. And my VP of operations was also male. Both of these guys had been working on it. So this is the first actual meeting that I'm going to with this client. Really cool people, great people. Bunch of, you know, bunch of guys from the technology world, bunch of Southern guys, bunch of old white Southern guys, let's just say, sitting at this restaurant. So I go in there with my two, you know, my sales and my VP of operations, and I walk in. We're going to meet at the restaurant, so they're all sitting there, and then there's these two, three chairs, you know, we sit there, and all these guys are all talking to each other. I'm the only woman at the table. They're all having this conversation, talking about football or whatever, basketball, you know, I'm not a sports fan. But anyway, and then one of the people sitting next to me turns around, looks at me, and he says, are you the project manager that's going to handle this account? And I looked at him, I didn't blink, and I said, no, I'm the president of the company. And you could hear everybody at the table just stop, like, they just stopped talking, right? So those guys didn't think, they actually thought that the other two guys were in charge. They didn't realize that, you know, those guys are actually working in my company. They didn't even think to take me seriously enough. At least one of them was nice enough to acknowledge my presence. The rest of them didn't even bother acknowledging that I was even there. Not that they intentionally did it. This is what you all probably know well as implicit bias. I'm sure you've heard this term. Nobody ever intends to be demeaning or disrespectful of people. It's just what they're conditioned to do. Not because anybody told them they have to do it. It's just the way they perceive the world the whole entire time. And I have to tell you that the person that was sitting next to me, he was so appalled. He was so apologetic the whole entire time that this was maybe 7 years ago. To this day, he is one of my most loyal clients. And he has switched companies 3 times. And the first call he makes when he goes to the new company is me. He'll always call me and he'll say, hey, I'm now working for this company and I really think you guys need to come, you know, work with this company. He very quickly realized it. But it's very difficult to be taken seriously. Now, I could have done one of two things, right? I could have sat there and got really angry about it. And I could have just said, how dare you? Not taking me seriously. Or the other way is to handle it, you know, very gracefully and say, I'm the president of the company, just leave it at that. You process it. It's on you, it's not on me. So, you know, what you guys need to be thinking about is you're going to find yourselves in these situations over and over and over again. You're gonna find yourselves in this situation at least once a week, maybe more. You probably already have. The best way that I have found, and again, depends on the situation. The best way I have found, be extremely confident, extremely polite, extremely respectful, but just let people understand that this is not what they peg you to be. That, you know, if they think that you're only capable of some things or you can't do some other things, don't tell them that you can do it. Just kind of make them understand and come to the realization that way by working harder, putting more into the situation than somebody else would, and wanting to prove that they are actually wrong. And that's the best way for people to do it. And once they realize that, they will be your advocates and champions forever. Instead, if you go there and say, what? I'm the the president of the company. How dare you speak to me like that? You know, what's that going to do? Not going to help anything. Not
going to
help anybody
anywhere,
right? So.
Do you sometimes, though, go home and vent about that?
I think it's just me as a person. I refuse to accept that people are ugly, and that served me well. I just refuse to accept it. That's on them, that's not me. I get upset about stuff, but if it's done maliciously, yes, I will go and vent about it. But if it is something that they did not intend to do, but they did it anyway, I always give people the benefit of the doubt. And I say, okay, they don't see it my way, so what can I do to bring them around so they can see it and accept it? So, you know, I don't know. And people always ask me things like, well, you know, have you had people biased against you because, you know, you're from another country or because of this and that? I always say, no, I don't think so. That's not true. I know that people are, but I just refuse to see it. I refuse to accept it because I'm going to make sure that you respect me for who I am without me having to scream it to your face. And I want you to get to that place because it's not me. Just because I tell you to do it doesn't mean that the other person's going to do it. But I can show you why you should, but I can't make somebody do something like that. So, you know. And one of the things that I want to, you know, also talk about a little bit is this whole entire time when our family has been going through so many struggles to try to get to where we are. The one thing that nobody in my family ever forgot is other people around us that don't even have the opportunities that we have. And that's sort of been the biggest thing that I feel very grateful that my family has instilled in all of us. Because you think your situation is bad? Look around you. There's people that are way worse off than you. You know, we're talking about not having enough money to go and get a great education. There are people that don't have their next meal. You know, so just keep things in perspective. So, you know, I just don't ever like to hear people complaining about, oh, but I don't have this, so I can't do this because of that. That's the thing that drives me crazy. I just can't stand when people have excuses for all kinds of things that I don't even see as excuses, right? Because if you really put your mind into something, there's always a way around you. There's always a way that you can find how to actually be successful at what you want to do. So we are really, really, really deeply involved in as much philanthropy as we could be involved in. And it doesn't mean, philanthropy doesn't mean money. You don't have to be wealthy to be giving. You can be giving of so many things. You know, all of us have so many gifts. We have the gift of knowledge that we can share. We have the gift of time that we can share. We have the gift of just your experiences that you can share with people. So, and if you have money, great. Share that too. You know, no one's gonna, I'm not gonna take it with you when you go. That's what I always say. I'm not gonna take it. You can try. Others have tried before you, but it's not going anywhere. You may as well make it useful for the people around you.
For the people applying for colleges, what advice do you have for them? And I know there's college students here. What advice do you have for them for graduate school?
For graduate school?
Money.
Especially, the really good thing about graduate school is there is a lot more money available to go to graduate school than there is for your undergraduate education. Because graduate schools offer TA positions, RA positions, you know, teaching assistantships, research assistantships, or just, you know, there are actual fellowships that you can get. If not, you know, what I have seen a lot of people do for graduate school is they finish their undergraduate education, take a couple of years off, you know, work, save up some money, and then go to graduate school. And also, depending on what you guys do, this is what I am hoping guys will take from this experience is if you all have something in the technology area that's part of your education, there are a lot of companies that will actually pay you to go back to graduate school. They will pay everything. Like you don't, you know, have to worry about paying for graduate school. So you could get, computer science degree, or you could get some other degree, you know, go to work for companies. And if they see that you have the aptitude, many of the big companies actually have programs that aren't paying for graduate school. But what I want to talk to you guys about is undergraduate school as well, not just graduate school, because you guys are closer to that. I'm on this board called the Council on Post-Secondary Education. It's a board that, it's a state board. There's about 12 of us from around the state that are on this board. And the job of this board is to look at all the colleges and universities in Kentucky. And we do a lot of things. We help set tuition. We, you know, it's basically an overseeing board that oversees every single college and university. And I didn't even know we had so many colleges and universities until I got invited to join this board. And you know, this is a governor appointed board, and I am unbelievably honored to serve on it because I get to be in Frankfurt all the time. I get to meet with all of our leaders all the time. So, you know, I get to go talk to them and tell them the problems that a lot of students are facing. But I hear from a lot of people that say, I don't want to go to college because I cannot afford it. And one of the reasons I told you the story of what my family did, I'm not asking your parents to do anything, you know, to go sell their homes and their cars and everything else, which you guys are in college. But you guys have a lot of different ways that you can apply for college. There are loans, there are grants, there are scholarships. And when I hear people say, I can't go to college because I can't afford it, I know there's a large element of truth to it, but they haven't taken the next step of trying to figure out how to solve for the problem. We all know the problem exists. You know, my family couldn't afford to pay for college, and your families may or may not be able to afford to pay for college. None of us can pay for college the way it is right now. It's very expensive. It's really, really expensive. But I just want you guys to not use that as a reason not to consider going to college. And going to college doesn't mean that you all have to go to, you know, four-year college or a big school like Uval or UK. We have a lot of great institutions around the state. And honestly, I'm offering myself as a resource for you guys. If you want to go to college, if you need help, I'll sit down with you and we'll look for, you know, funding opportunities. I'll go talk to Frankfurt and say, hey, what are you going to do? I've got all these students that are interested in going to college. How can you come up with some? There's resources. It takes time. You have to be able to, like, sit down, spend the time, get the applications, talk to people. But there are resources. So if you have other reasons why you don't want to do it or you can't do it, fine. Just don't do it because of money. And I mean that very seriously. Because once you have that education, you know, and you fast forward to like where I am, and you think about all the stuff that my family had to do, you know, 25 years ago, how does it matter? It's all been paid back in spades, right? Because then you guys are going to go out in the workforce, you're going to make the money, you're going to pay off the loan. All of that will come. But if you miss the window of opportunity right now, then that's going to pretty much be impossible to go back and recapture. It's a window. It's an opportunity that you just want to take very seriously. I know you all are, and that's why you all are here. But the problem that I see is people are very easily influenced by what they're hearing from their peers. You will go home, you'll talk to your friends or families or people, you know, that have been your childhood buddies in your neighborhood. They're gonna say, oh yeah, that's too expensive. I'm just gonna go, you know, get a job in retail, or I'm gonna go get a job in, you know, something else. It's not gonna take them very far. It really is not. You know, so don't miss this opportunity and don't use lack of resources. Because at some point you guys are gonna go back and say, oh gosh, I wish I hadn't done that. You know, I had all these people telling me not to do it and I did it anyway. Just don't want you guys to regret that. So, and let's see, where are we today? So, where we are today is, let's go to my brother's story. He took his company public, did very well, you know, made it a multi-multi-billion-dollar company, right? He became so successful, and I'm not saying everybody is going to get there, but what difference does it make? It's just money at the end of the day, right? I mean, now he's on starting his next thing. He's moving on to kind of go back and start everything from scratch again. Start the journey all afresh. It's continuous learning, continuous improvement. You reach a point and you go, okay, I've done all of this. Now what do I do? Okay, let me go find another area and go kind of do it all over again. Because I want to wake up every day feeling like I have something to get up and do. You know, so it's kind of the same thing that drives me. You know, the money has never been the thing that's driven me personally, ever. At no point, ever. When we had none, it was fine. When you have enough, that's fine. It's always the same thing. But it's always the need to learn new things, the need to help other people and help them with whatever it is that they need. So, you know, we're doing a whole lot of different things from a philanthropy standpoint. There's some scholarship funds that we've set up. There's a lot of different things that we continue to do, and we want our kids to be able to do the same things. And we want everybody that comes through here to have the same mindset. You guys need to always be thinking about somebody a little less fortunate than you guys and see how you can give. It will pay itself back in spades, guys, just to be able to go and help another person. Help make a small difference in their life. Honestly, there is nothing more enriching. Not enough dollars in this world can give you the same level of satisfaction as helping another person and seeing their happiness and their success and what it means to them because you did something for them and they were able to take it and, you know, get some value out of it. Somebody can write a check for, you know, $1 million, it still won't feel as good. I'm telling you because I've seen it. You know, it's the small things. So that's kind of what, you know, I'm hoping that you guys use this opportunity to learn, use this opportunity to network, get to know people, use this opportunity to, when you, all the other speakers come, get to know them really well. There's going to be some pretty influential and important people that are going to be speakers. So talk to them, make the connection, make them see who you are, make them remember who you are. Tell them, you know, stay in touch with them. There's nothing more important than networking. This is your opportunity to network with some people that you will otherwise not encounter. Not because, you know, they're too cool or too high and mighty to like come talk to us, but it's just our paths don't cross normally. And that's what we're trying to create here, is a way for different paths to cross. The Lieutenant Governor is gonna be here. I don't know if you know her. So she's basically our deputy governor for the state. And she is an engineer. She also just happens to be African American, but that's besides the point, right? But she's the governor, she's second in command of our state. And she's gonna come talk to you. Think about what that means for you guys to be able to network. You guys wanna find internships in government? Call her, email her. You wanna go do something next year? You wanna, you know, have an opportunity to see the inner workings of government, call her. Our mayor's gonna be here. You wanna do something in metro government? That's your way to do it. You know, so just kind of use all of these opportunities. And then there are some other very, very interesting and honestly pretty powerful people that are gonna come talk to you guys over the next few weeks. So just use it. Use every bit of it. And that's kind of what I'm hoping that you guys will take away from this. So ask me anything. Nothing is off limits. What questions do you have? What can I tell you? Anything?
So when you made the switch from molecular science to technology, mm-hmm. did your parents support you?
Yes. My parents were supportive the entire time of everything I did, as long as it was always furthering what I was doing, and as long as it was not, I don't think I can do it, so I'm just not gonna do it. As long as it was not that, my parents were very supportive of whatever I wanted to try. You know, not that we knew how it was gonna work out. There's always a risk, right? So, but on the other hand, as long as you're moving forward rather than staying still, I think it's important. And I can't say that everybody has the same situation, so I'm not gonna pretend like everybody has the same level of support. You know, you guys probably already have a good level of support. The fact that you're here doing this means that, you know, there's some level, but there's always challenges from, you know, house to house people. And it's not their fault sometimes. If you don't have families that are not very supportive, don't hold it against them. Think about their experiences and where they come from. They never grew up in an environment being exposed to those kinds of things or opportunities or all this newfangled stuff you're talking to them about. They just don't know. Don't hold it against them. Just patiently explain to them why this is going to open all kinds of amazing doors for you in the future, and just kind of work your way from there. Because if you try to stand up to them and fight with them, parents will shut you down in a second. You guys already know that.
What career did your mom have?
You know, my mom actually is, she has a degree in the life sciences also. But what she had as her career is she was helping my grandfather build his business. So she did all the accounting, all the finance. So she did all of that. And she did the same thing, you know, with my dad when he was kind of getting started as an entrepreneur. And she still does that for me today. She maintains all of my back end finance for my business. I still have her helping me with all of that. So she is one of the strongest people that I know, but she's also one of the quietest people that I know. So just because somebody doesn't say a lot, don't underestimate people, because they, at the end of the day, can be the thing that holds everything together. So, you know, you have to always kind of never, when you're in, that's a good question, you know, when you're in a situation, in your group situation, group dynamics, it's because you don't hear somebody speak up, or you know, somebody's kind of there just sort of watching in the background, they may be the most powerful person in the room, just haven't said anything. But that's kind of what she did. But again, for her, you know, education is everything.
Yeah. Did you ever think that you would end up here, like owning your own company?
No, I didn't think that, but I always wanted to do that. I just didn't know how I was going to get there, but at every point in my life, I always knew I wanted to do something for myself because I had seen that growing up in my house. But here's the interesting thing. My husband, on the other hand, never ever been around entrepreneurs. Like his entire life, he's never been around them. So when his dad is a scientist, his mom is a researcher. So he comes from a completely different world. You know, his dad is a nuclear scientist, actually. So he only knows, like, all of this whole academic and non-entrepreneurial world. And when I met him, you know, he thought we were kind of crazy people, right? Because we're entrepreneurs, we're risk takers, we want to do all this stuff. But now he is the biggest champion of entrepreneurship and doing something on your own. So just because you guys are not around it, and you haven't grown up around it, and you don't see it in your homes, doesn't mean that you can't go out and do it, because you look at a lot of people that are very successful as entrepreneurs. They did not come from entrepreneurial homes. They came from regular homes. They just had the desire to go out and do something for themselves. And so anybody can be an entrepreneur. And I urge everybody to think about being an entrepreneur, because there is nothing more rewarding than just creating something for yourself. Working in big companies and having these big, great jobs, those are also great paths. But you could still do that and be an entrepreneur in your philanthropic life, right? You could still get the best of both worlds. Go out and create something, create an organization, create, you know, a community foundation, you know, where you live, do something. Just because you have a job doesn't mean that you can't be an entrepreneur.
Another question.
Yeah.
Books do you read?
Right now, I'm actually reading The Hillbilly Elegy. All right. I saw somebody say yes.